the agenda. Any desire to move any items around on the agenda? No? Okay, I'll do Okay. It's not much on the agenda. I think we're going to have a quick meeting. And so the third item on the agenda that is comments from the chair, there's a few things I wanted to invite Kim to talk about, and something he forwarded, the downsizing group. But first, I just want to acknowledge that our planning department has been operating without a zoning administrator implementing new zoning, and so we're going to have a pretty thin meeting tonight. And as when you get the new zoning administrator in and we're fully staffed, then we'll be able to move up and get things going. So we just have to be a little bit patient right now. Or we have to do the work ourselves. So those are our options.
We'll be patient.
We always have options. So.
Just to acknowledge that some people are working a lot right now. And then, are you at liberty to announce the new zoning administrator?
It is Meredith Strobridge Crandall. So she grew up in the area, so some people might know her by her maiden name. And she's a VLS grad from, I want to say like 05 or 06. So she's got her JD. But she lives in Worcester and was interested in doing this and focusing on her family and spending a little bit more time working in Montpelier. So it's going to be great. I think she'll be a great fit.
Nice bike ride.
Is she still 8/10 then?
She's still 8.8.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's fantastic.
So it's very good. We've got an excellent candidate. I think she'll be good. So we, in addition to everything else, with the vacancy, we have been renovating the office downstairs, so it's kind of all pulled out.
Nice colors.
Switched places. Mm-hmm. Yep. So we switched offices, so I'm now, if you come in, I'm on to the right. I'm where Sarah used to be.
Yeah.
And Meredith is in my office.
Did you get a zoning permit for all this renovation?
Yeah.
A building
major site plan.
A building permit for your colors.
So that's good. That was, a lot going on, so.
Great, that's good news. And Kim forwarded an email from the downsizing group. I don't know if you want to.
I just thought it would be of interest as to what the building is going on in town. Everybody's yammering about housing. That's what's happening. Those projects, I don't think it's going to solve many problems. And some of them are out of town, of course. But,
Kim, was there any mention of the Main Street project on there?
The French Block?
No, the one up on Main.
No.
109 Main, or I can't remember what the number
250.
Is. 250, right.
Last I had anything to do with that, that whole hill is clay.
Welcome to
McArdle saying you build something on it, it may start that whole hill and slide down. And so before you do any of that stuff, you gotta get some good engineering. And I know they mix. Whenever you see people pick up trucks and they're huddled around it with notebooks, you know you're in trouble. So we had some of those guys around. And then I haven't heard a word.
Years, right?
It's been a long time. It could have been
They were working. Yeah, they worked last year on it.
Oh, okay.
And then they put in some. I think they put in sketch plan.
They did
for a PUD, but they never submitted a final, as far as I know.
No, they didn't.
So they'd be under the new zoning.
They're going to be under the new zoning. Yeah.
I would think so.
Yeah.
Think that if you don't follow up, you lapse. So, I don't know what's going on with that.
Okay, I just wondered. I didn't see it in there, but
one iteration was to do so-called cottages, which I think would be a sensible use of that land.
less disruption.
But not many people ask me about it, so we'll wait and see. You all know I'm on that subject, but of course I'm recused from any discussions if there's any action to be taken on 250 Main.
At least that allows you to speak at meetings.
What's that?
It allows you to speak at at development review and other meetings because you're a budding landowner.
Sure.
So.
That's a good reminder, though.
Yeah. But I don't think it'll show up at this table because there isn't any reason for it.
Great.
Mm-hmm.
Those are my comments.
I also sent out the links to several different links, and I'm not convinced the ORCA one worked, so I sent out the one through Net Zero Vermont, which is much easier to navigate.
Thank you for doing that.
Yeah,
thank you. It came in this afternoon.
Yeah, I know. It was not early. I was...
it's okay. We have a little time.
I kind of fell asleep since we didn't have a meeting 2 weeks ago.
I know, It was with the... Sarah leaving.
Yeah, made sense.
I had to miss the meeting too, so it seemed to. We'll just skip that meeting.
I could give just a brief report on my visit to the Historic Preservation.
Sure.
People.
That'd be great.
There were two meetings, I think. One was a public meeting in this room.
Mm-hmm.
And Kirby testified, and several others. I hate that PowerPoint in the dark, and you can't either see that or know who's speaking. Visually, to me, it was a real bust. I told the committee that you didn't agree with me, but I think it did. They did cultivate some people that are interested in the subject, and they testified, and it was a good start. I went to the next meeting, and Sarah McShane brought design review ordinances from about five different cities, and we were passing them around the table, and I can't stand this. This is your guy's job. If you're going to get an idea, run it through your expert, and we'll have a look at it. One of the things that was presented at that meeting was a 500-600-word essay by my friend, his name is now
Ben Huffman.
Ben Huffman. His essential idea is that historic preservation is a form of punishment. We should be punished equally, or we should not do it at all. And I wrote a little memo back to the committee. I think I sent it to all of you. Okay. But it's, and I haven't followed up with the historic people. I don't know where they're at. They must have had one more meeting. But I think the idea was, well, you can imagine those discussions. Everybody looks at an ordinance and says it's too vague and I don't know what it means. And everybody agrees on that, but they can't agree on anything else. So that was going to go to the expert. I did go up and tour Cliff Street again and the whole area. And I think I figured out why it was. All during this whole controversy, I was never able to get any historic preserver to tell me why it was in the historic district. And Huffman wanted to know that early on. And I said, yeah, before I throw something out, I want to know why it's in there. But nobody, literally nobody, could tell me any historical period or buildings or whatever that said this should be in a historical district. But when I went up there and I did a little research on the beginnings of Montpelier, that's where this city began. People would come down the rivers and they were probably polluted as hell and stank, and everybody went uphill, up on the hills to get away from the rivers, and they flooded and created problems. And it's really, to me, it's like Mount Everest. It's important because it's there.
And it is so visible from the downtown. I mean, it really is.
Yeah, and it really is a very unique collection. Just the houses that are built hanging off of a cliff. There's some extraordinary things that go on up there that are really interesting. And my son, who's on the Design Review Commission, a somewhat frustrated architect, but he says, look, I don't care anything about history, what I care about is design, and I want materials that are, he says, authentic. He says, don't ask me what authentic is, but if you want to slap vinyl on something, which is, or aluminum window frames and things like that, these kind of materials really detract from the way the building was designed and diminish the historical, the trip down memory lane, if you want, but the whole history of that place. So I'm hoping seemed to me you could come up with criteria that didn't necessarily historical things. We talked about preservation of buildings that are uniquely built in an interesting environment and twisting all those corners. And I think giving a little thought, you could come up with a criteria that look to good design.
It look beyond just individual buildings, because that's a neighborhood that acts together. It's not one particular building is unique up there. So, you know, if they expand this to look at some neighborhood criteria too, I think that would be useful for that particular group. I mean, it's like the Meadow. You know, the Meadow has a really unique character too. So,
I think there's some creativity that might even satisfy people. I'm never going to satisfy everything, but I'm hoping the historical people won't just dig in and say everything has to be historically correct. I think there's a much more creative way to look at some of these places. So we'll see what happens.
Well, I talked to Eric after the presentation. During the presentation, I made some comments about social issues being part of this and making sure that our community is accessible to everyone, socioeconomic backgrounds. And that's my concern with historic preservation, is that it can be used as a way to keep things kind of wealthy in a place. But then afterwards I spoke to Eric and about that a little bit, and he mentioned using design review as a kind of a service, which is something that I could definitely get on board with, and like approaching it like, some of it's just changing people's perception of what it's about, but also making sure that the rules aren't so draconian that it does feel more like a service where people are going to go. They go and they get these ideas and suggestions from more knowledgeable people. And if we can get to a point where design review is like that, then I think that would be a success. And all the while thinking about those social issues and making sure that it's not used as a barrier. I think that's what I'm going to be thinking about.
Harvey, how do you see it necessarily as a barrier? I'm trying to get an understanding of what you're saying.
Where it's where people feel like they can't afford to live somewhere because of the requirements on them, that they feel like that they can't comply with design review. And
in an existing house that's already...
Well, we can't use material that's more affordable.
Yeah.
Potentially.
Yeah.
Potentially they could use a similar material.
But if design review can be set up to tell people this is a nice looking and cheaper way to do your project, that's the kind of service that could be great.
And I have a similar concern in working in affordable housing. I have a lot of feelings about historic preservation because it just, you know, also thinking about energy efficiency, oftentimes, like the state historic preservation almost made the French Block developer keep those windows, which would be, you know, very not good for operability, not good for energy efficiency. So I think there's that concern as well.
Yeah, I think the sort of rigid application of the department standards are definitely a problem. And technically, design review is an advisory committee now, so it seems that it would just be a matter of maybe making there an informal approach first before they actually came to design review.
I think there's a lot of room, and we can get creative about building up how it is as a service and potentially not change a whole lot, which I think you guys would be happy, some folks would be happy about. I think that approach, but looking at it like that as a service for the public and kind of building around that.
Yeah, and it's even possible too that maybe that service could expand somewhat to allow for some of the larger homes that the owners would like to subdivide, you know, as basically as we're allowing them on the zoning, to do that in a respectful way to their historic fabric too, which is certainly very easy to do.
Right.
Generally, not always, but generally, yeah. It's just a matter of looking at something one way as opposed to another way. Hoped that maybe one of the things that would come out with their workbook is that they would have examples of this is how not to do things. Of course, you don't want to have any examples from Montpelier. You'd have to find them somewhere else. But, you know, just to, because I think if people could visualize what the problems are, it's much, much easier to see, oh, yeah, that would be a better way to do it. I could use wood there instead of vinyl.
Well, we'll see what the commission comes up
with. They certainly have some good examples. I mean, the ones that we saw before. Was that the one from Stowe? Middlebury, maybe?
I like Shelburne.
Shelburne.
I think that's a really good.
What's that?
I think that's really good. You can, they tell you why this will sort of mess things up. Look what's on there. I read the thing and went over there and looked at the town just when they opened their new home for the aged. And it's really an extraordinary job they did there. It's compelling and it's an inviting environment. So,
you working on that and stuff?
Yeah, I went through many, many iterations of that project. I think I built it yet. Some days it looked like it wasn't going to happen.
Good reminder. Okay. Well, thank you for attending these meetings, Kirby, too. And Barb, of course. To hear how it keeps developing.
Yeah. They seem very willing for us to continue to participate with them.
That's good.
As they're going through this. So maybe Kim and I can trade off going to meetings.
Yeah.
Well, I think they'll come up with their expert I didn't hear anybody talking about anything very creative, to be candid, but the game is really early. And I don't think that the committee has really thought very deeply about this. They know what historic preservation is, but I don't think they looked at it close to them from a regulatory point of view.
I have one other question. I got asked by one of the city councilors if we were going to be there on Wednesday. We're not, right? We're not on
the
agenda.
Not this Wednesday, no.
No.
Okay.
The ninth.
Okay.
May 9th.
Right.
We did talk.
So Mike's going to tell us what we're trying to do.
Yeah, all right. So
I
we'll
think
talk
we
about
talked
that.
About this at the last meeting, but if we didn't, I got an email inviting me to come just introduce myself to the city council and say what we're up to on May 9th. And anyone else who wants to attend is welcome to come and represent the planning commission.
I look forward to hearing what it is we are up to.
So it wasn't specifically to get direction from them. Regarding
my understanding was it was just so that the new city councilors can get a sense of what are all the committees that are happening and where what they're working on and who the chairs are.
we do
have that turnover with three city councilors. Is that accurate, Mike?
Yeah, there's going to be that. The planning commission is going to be presenting what we're up to and kind of making some recommendations. So one of which would be, you know, what do you want the planning commission and staff to be working on? And our recommendation is that we should
work on the
working on the city plan, and we're going to kick off and do it this way. And we're just kind of, you know, we're already starting it, and we're just waiting for them to kind of give us a thumbs up that says that's a great idea. Work on that.
It's always better if you could say, "Here's our proposal for
how
we want
to
move
forward. Here's our proposal
for
what
Can
to do." We won't be the only ones there. You won't be the only ones there. Planning Commission, because planning also represents housing, so the housing task force is also going to be at the May 9th meeting. And there may be some other groups that may show up. You might be going for this week for MEAC.
Yes,
though.
We are. Yeah, definitely. But
for what?
MEAC. The Energy Committee is this week, this Wednesday.
Right.
But planning isn't for another 2 more weeks.
Oh, good.
So there'll be some other groups that may be there as well with the housing. I think I mentioned it also to the Conservation Commission. I don't know when they were planning to attend later with community services,
yeah.
Or if they were going to be attending. But,
I think theirs is the 23rd.
But that's kind of the message we're trying to do, is to get people to come out. Because the council is going to have to make priorities. They've got meetings coming up in a couple of weeks, and they have to start to come up with recommended priorities of what they would like to have the city manager working on, which then filters down to what I would be working on. So when it comes down to they have 10 goals and enough staff to do 4 things, you know, what ends up being the priority. So I've been pitching everybody to say, well, this would be a good time if you want to be one of those priorities to make sure that introduce yourself and let the city council know, and you guys will always have work. Just filters through you guys, but some of the more, you know, bike path people or trails or parks or whatever.
Taylor Street's a go though, or just waiting for a shovel or something?
Most of the big projects are queuing up to go for this year. So that's mostly working through Public Works and less through the planning department at this point. All we're doing is kind of some grant assistance and grant management. So.
But it looks like the whole TIF idea has been sewn up to build a parking garage.
It's multiple pieces. That'll be start this week and finish up on the 9th with the announcements. But it's a multiple... It has multiple, so TIF is used, tax increment financing. You collect up the money from the private development, and you are going to use it on the public investment, or you can flip it around. We have public investment needs, and if we fix these needs, then we can allow more economic development. So the proposal is to work on a number of things, one of which is the parking garage, another of which is to do transportation and utility improvements. The utility improvements are mostly on Berry Street. The transportation improvements are mostly on Main Street. So we've got, in order to fix the Berry and Main intersection, if we do a roundabout, then we have to have more roundabouts. If we do lights, we have to time all the lights. So it becomes a whole network. And we can't develop more housing on Berry Street, especially a large project on Berry Street. So let's say Sabin's Pasture and a couple other projects came in for Berry Street. They'll never, if they get into Act 250, they'll never get through Act 250 without improvements to that intersection. So, so we can use TIF to go and take some tax money from those properties to come down and fix this intersection. So that's just one example of the...
Does that come to us, or...
You approve the district first, and it none of this will come through the Planning Commission, but you approve the district first through the City Council. That doesn't approve any projects, that just approves the concept of what you're trying to do and lays out some likely projects and some likely public investments that are going to help the public and private. And then you go to the VEPSI board and you get approved, but you're not... That doesn't approve you to build the parking garage, for example. You would then have to come back to the voters with a bond vote that would say, we would like to spend $2 million.
Well, who approves the TIF project?
City Council.
And that's, it starts and ends there. It
starts and ends at the City Council, yes.
And on Wednesday, they're going to approve the idea, the district.
They're not going to approve it this Wednesday. They're presenting it this Wednesday, and they're going to approve it on the 9th. So we'll approve it
2 weeks. Okay.
2 weeks. At least that's the schedule.
So, taking this opportunity, I mean, here's what I understand our goals to be right now, and what we want to focus on in order of priority. One, city plan with... The proposal for that is to have the kickoff meeting, and we'll get into that more on item 5. Two, the official map. And three, zoning amendments as needed. So as we receive application, as the planning department receives application for our various projects and realizes there's quirks in the zoning bylaws that need to be resolved, we'll take those up as those come and as they make sense. Based on input we received from Mike and our new zoning administrator. Are there any other?
I think design reviews on that list.
Oh, you're right, it is. I see us as more of playing a, I guess with the official map and design review, we're more of a liaison there than we are in the lead.
So who's doing the official map then, if we're in liaison?
I'm working on it with the Conservation Commission.
The Conservation Commission, the Parks Commission, and Mike's been working on it with them. But I mean, I think ultimately they'll provide something that we could weigh in on, but I don't think it has to go through us in order to go to City Council.
No, the official map would go through you guys first.
Oh, it would? Okay. Okay. So, and then design review would also go through us, right? So
yeah, I don't know if they'll be proposing anything for adoption this year, historic preservation.
Okay, so...
That's my guess. So I think those three are probably the three top priorities.
So the design review language for the zoning bylaws. Okay. So the priorities for 2018 would be city plan, official map, and zoning amendments as needed. Potentially for 2019, it would be city plan, design review language, zoning amendments as needed. I'm hoping we can get the official map done this year.
Yes.
But We also talked about doing that in conjunction with the city plan, so I think we'll have a better idea about when it makes sense to propose that as we get further down the road in the city plan.
Yeah, and I'll have a little bit of an update when we get to
okay.
the city plan.
So let's move on. So that was item three. item four, general business, comments from the public about something not on the agenda. There's no members of the public present, so we'll move forward to item five, which is the city plan update discussion. And there is a variety of things that we kind of thought about doing. I don't know, Mike, you put this on the agenda, so maybe you had something specific in mind. I have some other things to think about, too. But why don't you start?
So the update I have on that was that even though I didn't meet with you guys 2 weeks ago, I did owe a couple of meetings. One was to the Housing Task Force, and one was to the Conservation Commission, and they had a couple of members of the Parks Commission who were there. So, starting with that meeting, the Conservation Commission meeting, I presented some of the official maps that I had collected up from around other towns, and it was kind of timely, because over the past month or two, there has been a lot of discussion on the listservs that I'm on about official maps. Sure. Some other communities have been considering it and wondering how it has been for work, didn't work for other communities. So we had a good conversation about what they wanted on their on the map itself. What do the colors mean? You know, we had that green print map, and I was like, you know, you're talking about this, so let's put some words down of what does this corridor mean. This corridor is an area where, you know, we don't need the entire 100-foot corridor. We want a path somewhere in this 100-foot corridor, so we just need a 20-foot easement or in fee.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what are you looking for? So if they could, and this is what's on the Parks and Conservation Commission to-do list, is that they're going to put that together. You know, this pink blob here is showing where we would want to park. This is 300 acres in size, but we really only need 50 acres. But we need 50 acres that's somewhat usable somewhere in this blob. And that gives us the opportunity not to necessarily specifically say this is exactly where we're going to have a park, but we want to park somewhere in here. And then if a property comes up where there's a development in that area, the city would have the right of first refusal and could decide whether this is the area that they want. May or may not for a number of reasons, but they're supposed to kind of go through and refine the map and work on it a little bit to kind of identify what it is they're asking for. Do they want it in fee? Do they want a third color? Because they had one that was trails, which we assume is going to probably be easements that they're looking for. Second color that was on that map was for parkland. And we're like, okay, well, parkland you probably want to own in fee, so that would be a different one. And then there was a discussion of whether they wanted to also identify other environmental parkland, let's call it. So, you know, these preservation pieces. If we had a wetland complex, would we want to buy that? It's not really parkland from the standpoint that we want everyone visiting it, but it also really isn't developable, and we would be disappointed to see this area develop. So they're supposed to look and see whether they wanted a third.
That was a vernal pool idea, at least one of them.
Yeah. So they're going to look at some ideas and come up with an identification. So that way I can start to work on crafting that next piece, which is, okay, now that I understand what this map means, we would adopt it as an official map. But what surprised me was that when I did the homework on other official maps, every other community, none of them have any ordinance that is that goes along with the official map. They just adopt the map, and they follow state law on enforcement. So we felt that's probably not a prudent way to kind of manage this, especially if we have some of these that are easements. And we really should have a process where if somebody comes in with an application, we can say, well, here's our ordinance, our official map ordinance that goes along with the official map. And it maybe it's just two or three pages or two pages that really kind of lays out here's the process.
To be more transparent.
Yeah, if you come in, we're going to, you know, we automatically get this here, and it's going to have this. Who do we send it to?
The first
zoning application comes in. Do we send it to the Conservation Commission for comment, or do we not? Do we send it to the Parks Commission for comment, or not?
It's probably
going to
help with the adoption process of the official map, because I can imagine that if I see that there's a park right on my property, I might not know what that means start to worry. So having something written of what that process would be and when it would get triggered, I think that's key too. It's going to be really helpful. I like that idea a lot.
So my job, while they're working on that, my job is going to be just to start to work to kind of create this ordinance that would kind of go along with a process step. And certainly if you know of anyone who actually has an ordinance, I'd love to steal from it. I don't know.
Official map ordinance
that kind of a process that kind of goes along with it. But certainly not South Burlington, Hinesburg, Milton.
I haven't read the statute, but that must have some pretty good guidance as to what.
It's much more of a process, but it doesn't go through and say, for example, somebody comes in and the zoning permit, somebody comes in and decides to build a house. We've identified a park on the top of Sabin's Pasture. Somebody comes in and puts in a permit, I want to build a house on the top of Sabin's Pasture. The official map has been triggered. There's a process, you know, relatively short, that's in statute that you would follow, but you could extrapolate on that to go through and say, okay, well, what does the zoning administrator do when that application comes in? Do we forward it to the Parks Commission for their input? Do we, what does, and in a lot of cases, a lot of the other ordinances were much more, the official maps were much more specific. Because official maps are supposed to be about roads and utilities and sewer and water. And if you build a house where we want to build a road, then we're going to take it.
I see.
And we know exactly where that road is going to go. In this case, they're kind of laying out, this is where we would like a trail. And it's a 100-foot wide corridor. And it might be over here, it might be over here. We only want a 20-foot easement somewhere in this 100 feet. And so when it kind of comes into that, it kind of ends up with a slightly different, I don't know, I think you need to have a process. And maybe we work with our attorney, and our attorney feels we're better off not constraining ourselves with that process. But it just seems like, it seems to me, I would want to, as a zoning administrator, not be going back to statute, just going and saying, I guess I just pumped this up to city council. And
the whole point of the official map is to take the place of necessity in a condemnation. Mm-hmm. And if you have a 100-foot trail area on your official map, I think there's going to be enormous opposition. It's one thing to say, okay, 20 feet snake wanders down here and that's it. But once you open it up to deciding what pieces of this corridor are going to be used, then you have a committee making a decision that is essentially a taking, justifiable taking.
Isn't the structure you're talking about the committee saying anywhere within this band we would want it, and you as a property owner can decide?
It would be more of a, they would want to be able to try to negotiate how that would go, rather than saying this is specifically, because I think they're trying to avoid some of the upfront time and expense that it would cost to very specifically map every single, the location of every single trail and every single 20-foot wide path, and sometimes they can be pushed left or right.
So getting to what you were saying, Kim, it sounds like only actions that would make, say, the trail impossible to go through that area would really trigger. As long as you could still do the trail, then activity in the area shouldn't necessarily trigger, because it's not, it wouldn't, the trail's still possible. Is that kind of what you're getting at?
No, I think my problem is, in effect, the official map is a first step in condemnation.
Yeah.
It says, we as a city declare we need this for the public good.
Right.
And
but so that need, so what I was getting at is that need wouldn't be there unless something were going was going to happen that like cut the trail off basically, right. And that would trigger a need to do something right then.
Oh no! To me, I think the, if you're going to have a trail, it's got to have a beginning and an end over private property. And if you're going to, I foresee difficulties in allowing a committee to massage what we're actually going to take. Because I think that's a, you would then have to go to the city council and say, we agree with you, or we disagree with you. And I can see no end to problems with that.
Like I said, my push, so the question that'll come up for them is to come up with their first map. That will have to come through this committee when we get it, and we'll put together an ordinance that'll help to at least lay out the process. So those are kind of the tasks that were laid out in that meeting, was that they're going to work on their piece to kind of make sure they can clearly identify, this is what we want on this, parks, this is what we want on this, and this is...
So one request that maybe I should make to City Council, I don't know, whether I should do it at the May 9th meeting or another time, but I think it would help us in our discussion of the official map once it comes to us if we also had the legal opinion at the same time so that we can have actual advice as we're wading through these challenges.
Yeah, I don't think I'm going to be able to develop the ordinance part without the legal input. So
okay. So it should be happening before.
Yeah, that
we get
will happen, okay. And then I think we may, what we didn't do too much with the zoning, but we may do for the other one, is just to bring in John or somebody from Stitzel to kind of sit down with us and just and go over it at least in one meeting to kind of lay out the range of options that we have. There's certain things we have to do, but then there's a certain amount of flexibility I think we have, and I think it's there aren't a lot of official maps out there, so we're, you know, and they don't get tested very often. So a number of people
good and bad.
Yeah, I think Hinesburg has said they've liked it. Alex likes it a lot. They put it out there for their parks and their roads, and the developers basically do exactly what you would hope they would do. The developer looks at the map and says, oh, okay, I have to build a road, so I'm going to build the road where the city has identified it on the official map, rather than try to fight the official map. Mm-hmm. You know, oh, I've got some recreation land that's identified as part of mine. Well, I will use that as my open space, and the city will buy my open space and add it to the park. So, you know, he hasn't had to implement it from his position, because it's always kind of developers have looked at the official map and followed it. Other places have voted, you know, somebody, I guess in South Burlington, had proposed to put a house where there was supposed to be a park. And it went up to City Council, and City Council was like, we're okay. We'll find another park somewhere else and not actually follow through on the official map. And that's allowed as well. So it's, you know, it has different things, and so we're hoping, I think, with the Parks Commission, you know, sometimes you just put something on the ground, and you hope that this will help developers who want to maybe do the right thing to know what the community's wishes are, and maybe they will work to make some things happen.
Do we really need an ordinance, though? Isn't it maybe just more of a policy, like an administrative policy?
Yeah, I mean, I'll look at to see if that's what it, if it needs to be an ordinance as a part of it or a policy or something. Yeah, something less than a written ordinance part.
Do you imagine this will take 30, 50 years, and managing another ordinance is just another thing to manage? And
as I think about this problem, the condemnation, as we know it, is always a negotiation. Coming Street Bridge, how much, what are we going to do, and how are we going to accommodate the land? And the beverage thing up here. So, condemnation triggers negotiation, so, but it takes place at the city council level, not at some committee level.
I think what we've seen in a lot of these other places is basically you're signaling, like, here's the path of least resistance, and it happens when development happens, and it's really not a big city council, you know, probably it's a 5-minute item on their agenda where they sign to accept something as part of a subdivision approval. So, like, final conditions of a subdivision are, you know, like, you will sign this part over to the city and accept it. It's not always like that.
I'm just having a hard time figuring out where that trail's going to go without a lot of legal issues about it.
Well, seems like there's still some work to be done.
Yeah.
So you mentioned you also met with a housing task force.
Yes, so housing task force I met with last week. I was actually meeting with them intentionally about our city plan update, because initially we were going to start off with just doing the housing plan first, and were they interested in coming and meeting with the planning commission to have a joint meeting, and so that was the agenda item, was for me to meet and talk about that. In between, we all met and decided we were going to have this all committees meeting, and they really like that. They think that's a great idea because they think it's going to be really effective to sit down, because this plan has so many places where there's overlap. You know, is energy or transportation or community services responsible for public transportation? You know, economic development and natural resources. You know, there's going to be some conflicting areas in there. Housing and conservation. They're just different ones that there's potential places where one's goals may not line up perfectly with another, and that's where planning commission, you guys are going to have to play referee and make a decision of what, you know, or where are we going to put something? Where do we put weatherizing houses? Is that a housing issue, or is that an energy issue?
Right.
And, you know, some of them are going to be obvious, and we're going to know where to put them. But
what is the function of the housing task force?
Housing task force is, they're a quasi-committee. They are a committee, but they're actually more of an ad hoc group. Nobody's actually appointed to the board. But they are members of Montpelier Housing Authority, Down Street, I think VCIL was on there, the Center for Independent Living was there for a while, but they're more ADA now. Jack works for Legal Aid, so he's trying to represent some of the issues and concerns of tenants.
Is he still serving on the task force?
He is. He was the chair. He stepped down from being chair, and because he's now a counselor, and so Jack is still on the committee. Mary Hooper's on the committee. So there's just a number of people who have always had a deep interest in housing and affordable housing, and what are the barriers, and so they work a lot with the housing trust fund and coming up with recommendations and kind of how to advance that different so they're really a really good group. I think, like any of the committees that we have, they're just, you know, a really talented group of people. Some folks from the state housing, Jen Holler's on there, and she was ACCB, so there's a number of folks who are.
What's their part in determining, doesn't the city allocate a housing fund as part of their budget?
Yes. There is a housing trust fund, and there is a separate housing trust fund committee who only meets about once a year to review housing trust fund applications. So that's one of the comments that is coming out, that we're thinking we just recommend merging those two. You know, maybe appointing a few members who would be the voting members of the trust fund, and make fiduciary recommendations on the trust fund. So we've got a couple of, we've got some recommendations on that committee, but the initial one was, you know, we wanted to invite them and have them because they're the farthest along on their chapter and their element. But they really think this is a great idea, so they wanted to, kind of compliment you guys on, not doing what I said, doing your own ideas, because they like your ideas.
I think it was the energy committee's idea.
Oh, was it?
We were pushing it, yeah.
Well, you guys get, whoever it is can pat themselves on the back, because the housing committee really liked that idea, so. So that was, they're looking forward to hearing when that comes out. I told them probably we're looking at probably sometime in June,
yeah,
I guess.
So the only piece is, do we need to meet with the IT specialist before we schedule that meeting with the all committees? I mean, that's the only hang up I see, is, I mean, other than the whole like scheduling of it. But
I don't think we need IT necessarily for the meeting, but we're going to need that to start. It'd be good to have him have that set up to start going forward. I guess it depends. I think we just have to start laying out what we want to present and what we want to get back. I think we just need to start having some big picture discussions of what we want to, what are the outcomes that we want to get out of this initial kickoff meeting. Because I think we can certainly go through and lay out a bunch of the pieces, but do we want have those Google Drive pieces set up ready to go at that meeting, start using them at that time, or I don't know.
Well, sending out a letter to all of the committee, it would be a great opportunity to explain how that could work, but we could send a follow-up letter if we needed to. I'm just thinking we could put everything into one letter to send to the committees. That would be ideal. But I don't want to hold up the meeting just because of that.
And
what are
he's interested in meeting. Seth is interested in meeting.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, I think if we could do it would be great. Okay.
So maybe you can see if Seth could come to our next meeting. And in the meantime, I could put together a letter that everybody could take a look at and comment on at that meeting, at our next meeting. And then we would plug in whatever the intro is that we decided made sense based on topic set. That sound like a good plan? The other question I have is, I've been kind of thinking about what kind of venue we would want to, where we would want to hold this. Do we have any budget for renting space? I assume we don't.
Is that a good assumption?
It's probably a good assumption, but it also, I think, would depend on what costs we were looking at.
Commerce is usually pretty good about letting communities meet up there.
Well, you're thinking, but that's off kind of, you have to drive there, right? It's not our walkable community.
It's walkable.
I was sort of thinking of a more like a skinny pancake or something kind of downtown where it's not City Hall, but something where if folks wanted to stay and socialize after the presentations, it would be more organic.
How big a group are we talking?
Well,
would we need something, like the Capitol Plaza conference room?
That would be much more expensive.
See,
that was what I was thinking. That's where the price comes in, is when you start getting into those spaces. But
we could meet here and then
Lost Nation upstairs.
Oh, upstairs, yeah.
Yeah, Lost Nation was one thought I had. I think you can reserve downstairs at Nikki. It doesn't cost anything. You just kind of have to have enough people buying drinks to make it worth their while.
We have, 45 committees?
Yeah, how many people?
Yeah.
How many committees are there?
Is it really?
Well, we're not going to have
all. There are almost 20 committees if you get down to details of all of them.
I don't even know if Lost Nation.
We wouldn't need input from all of them. I think we would need to do 12 different sections, right?
And as we mentioned, there's a lot of people who sit on multiple, so even if you had 12 of them, we're not going to get everybody, but we're going to
I like this idea, the downstairs in NECI. The only problem is we wouldn't have a visual aid aspect to it, but maybe that would help.
Maybe that's fine, yeah.
What do you suggest in the power 5-minute presentation?
Right. How about the pavilion?
There's the pavilion.
Do you have to pay for the pavilion?
I don't think so.
I'll find out.
But we want something that's like a conference room where we're facing each other, right? To be kind of bringing this up. Rather, that's where I was sort of, if you sit downstairs at NECI, I'm kind of imagining everybody around the room.
Except that's a lousy place for the meeting. I just don't see how you do it.
Energy, net zero, stuff.
It was the auditorium. So I was thinking, you know, maybe not something that was strictly a presentation.
Oh, that's true, because then it's not.
Yeah. My only concern.
State agencies can sort of go appropriately.
Yeah, the pavilion, my only concern there is that it wouldn't foster communication the same way that a smaller room would.
Right, right, yeah.
And we may, if we're looking at it, we may go and ask somebody to send one or two people rather than going and inviting the entire committee. So if we had 10 committee chairs that we invited, we might end up with 20 to 25
yeah.
people. But we're not inviting all 14 members of the energy committee.
Although they're welcome, I want everyone to be welcome because it is an opportunity.
Yeah,
to
that
connect.
It just defines the space.
If
we're going to invite everybody, then we have to have a space that can accommodate.
Well, maybe
upstairs.
We should have it here.
We could have it at the Lost Nation lobby area. I mean, that's a fairly large area when you set it up, not theater style, but more round table.
And that could work.
Do they have a projector screen?
We can get one.
A portable screen.
I think they did one of the.
Did an event there, but you have to be wary of their rehearsal schedule, and like sometimes stuff can be just set up so that it's a challenge.
Right, you have to
work
around.
We'll have to see if they've got a down. They've got a schedule, a down schedule that comes up during June or anything.
Or one of their dark nights. Just figure out.
Well, I know there were some times when I was in Barrie that the Opera House just had this, like, between this month and this month, they were really busy and had a lot going on.
Mm-hmm.
But then there was sections of time where it was generally open.
All right, well, I'll reach out to Lost Nation about that. And then that sounds like the best option we have. And then we could also reserve the NECI downstairs for anyone who wanted to mosey over after, but
maybe we can probably get some kind of catering or food set up.
If we could do that, that'd be better.
Because that's what, I mean, the Lost Nation does it for their intermissions.
Okay. Lost Nation charge us? Technically, it's not really.
No, they can't charge the city. We are a city,
mm-hmm.
So they can't charge us. It's just scheduling. That becomes the issue. So yeah, you want to talk to Kim.
Okay.
Just to find it. Yeah. Someplace where we can sneak in. I'd hate to have the big, huge block of rehearsals and performance off, because that would be most of June and part of June.
The chances of a conflict are pretty high, I think.
Well, they have nights that they're not.
I was hoping we had a fifth week.
They wouldn't even have a rehearsal.
Occasionally,
we'll
you get a fifth
see.
Week
might,
and go and say, oh, go for into the fifth week of June, because nobody will
have
anything, but there are only 4 weeks.
Well, my job for the next meeting will be to have some dates.
All right. Okay. And I'll try to have Seth come in, and I'll get him on the agenda to come in and chat with you about what you want. So think about what you want Seth to try to help set up, because he's, you know, he's the IT guy.
So that means, John, you think
about
it. Well, there's also just the general thing of, you know, we want something that's going to facilitate this type of input.
I can try to swing by maybe before the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Seth,
you make the most of his time here.
Were you going to start drafting the letter to the committees? I'm sorry, did you say that?
Yeah, I was thinking, I mean, I'll try to have some dates for the venue at the next meeting and a draft of the Yeah, and then I'll send that around for comments. We can discuss it at the next meeting. Maybe Kirby, maybe I can get your input on it before I share it with the broader group. Just so my sleep deprivation doesn't...
We can come out of sleep deprivation before.
Yes. Yeah, that's true. You're sleep deprived too. I forget. Because I'm
mostly
so sleep deprived. I forgot
it's
you're
not,
sleep
deprived. Yeah, being inflicted.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else on the city plan?
No,
discussion?
I think that was all
yeah,
I
yeah. Okay, so item 6, consider meeting minutes from March 26th.
I move their approval.
Second.
Any discussion? No? Okay, all those in favor of approving the minutes, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. It's unanimous. Last item on the agenda. Adjournment. Do I have a motion?
I'll move.
Carlos, second?
I'll second.
Okay, it's a non-debatable motion. Okay, all those who move to or accept the motion for adjournment, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we are adjourned.